like having a bit of crack with my friends or whatever, you know, as we all do, I'm sure. That's a, well, really, you know, you're different to me. How would you expect us to relate to you, Karl? But I have this thing I constantly do. It's, I don't know, it's involuntary. I can't stop myself. Like, I'd be in, one of my friends, we were on the tube in London, right? And I'd stayed with her for the whole weekend. She put me up, you know, fed me, which wasn't easy. And she's heading on to work and I'm getting off to change tubes to go to the airport. And no one talks to each other on the tube. Everyone's looking at the paper, not talking, just, all right, ignore everyone, pretend there's no one here. And as I get up, the devil comes on my shoulder and I just turned. And as I'm walking off, I went, anyway, I'll talk to you soon. Let me know if I'm the father. But there was a lot of us there that night. And I go and leave her to deal with it. Everyone in the car. Strangers were becoming friends. Did you hear what I just heard there? Is that...
You're very welcome to another edition of The Weekend Mix. And today we're having a chat with Limerick's probably most funniest guy, Mr. Karl Spain. Karl, how are you?
I'm good, I'm good. I'll accept that title now. I'll use it on posters.
I'd say you've used it once or twice before.
No, it's been said to me. I've been called the king of Limerick comedy. I've reminded people that, I don't know, was he born here, but Jimmy Carr's family are from Limerick.
That's right. He's an aunt and uncle, I think, in Limerick, isn't he?
He's still family in I think it's up in Ross Bryan. Because I didn't know. When I met Jimmy first, I said I was from Limerick, and he suddenly starts mentioning all the Limerick places. I was like, what? And Sean Walsh has been over loads. The godfather of stand-up comedy, Dave Allen, there's rumours he was born in Limerick. His family were from Dublin. I think his brother, a brother's born here, or he might have been born here. Mm. And even though he's from Tipperary, Pat Sharp been living in Limerick. So there's been a, I'm almost going, I'm the one coming forward with that. No, but they were technically, I don't think Jimmy Carr had any connection, really. I think, what a Seamus Carr. It's almost probably Seamus Gluestone, really. But
I think if you pass through Limerick now, Carl, you're just attached, you know. If you're anywhere good at all, we'll take you.
Well, they could have played for the Irish international comedy team. So that's...
Didn't do it. Listen, yeah. Karl, you of course, were born and raised in Corbally, in Limerick.
I was indeed.
How was that for you? How was your childhood growing up?
It was grand. It's funny. One of my early jokes was about, you know, people that just have this perception, of people who are not from Limerick, of Limerick just being rows of some closed up, some boarded up council houses, that's the whole city. But I grew up in Lower Park. Now, we converted the attic, which made the house better than it was. But there was an extension out the back. So it was a six-bedroom house. And I used to joke saying, yeah, it was really tough growing up in Limerick. We had a six-bedroom house. You know, we'd football goalposts in the back garden. And sometimes we didn't even have nets. You know, with a snooker table in the attic. And it was only a 6x3. So it was a very tough... McCourt, like, growing up, you know.
I think Angela's Ashes kind of really gave us a stigmata in Limerick City, you know. Everyone that hears Limerick City, oh, the rain and the dreariness.
My first joke was about the Cranberries. But my first proper routine was about Frank McCourt, and, you know, the movie was filmed during the monsoon season. the funny thing about Limerick in Angela's Ashes is there was no slums left in Limerick, so they had to go film them in Cork, which I always thought was lovely.
It was a nice bit of ironic for you, you know. You went on into CBS, Sexton Street. How was secondary school for you? Had you a target in mind, what you wanted to do leaving secondary school?
Absolutely none. I genuinely went through all my education not knowing what the hell I was going to be. I remember being bored in school. A lot. That's my one recollection of secondary school. It's just sitting there absolutely bored.
A lot of,
you know, you're meant to be listening or following. But it was just constantly just absolutely tuned out. And probably putting on a good resting face, like screensaver. Oh yeah, I'm really listening. And just a million miles away. I got into the top class, which was Patrick's, for those who know, you know, the this the classes were graded as the saints. So St. Patrick was seen as the best saint, I think. Oh, St. Nessin was the second best. And St. Senan and St. Malachy, well, they mustn't have been great saints at all. But I remember being bored there a lot of the time. And I just did enough to get through school. I wasn't particularly a class clown or anything like that. I did a TV show, went back and did a TV show about my time in school that's called Class Clowns. And I didn't feel, you know, some of the lads said, no, you were funny, but it wouldn't have been, I would have just been in amongst the herd, in the peloton, not trying to make any, myself noticed in any way.
I can't imagine JP McManus would be giving out scholarships today for comedians. So what brought you down that road, or where did you go after secondary school? Did you do third level?
I did. I went to Moylish and I did applied chemistry for a while. I actually didn't remember applying for it.
Did Carl apply chemistry for a guy that didn't do a whole lot of school? That was a shooting above your weight, was it?
It was. I had no interest in it, and I was working full time. I was a manager in Burgerland in William Street. I don't know if you remember Burgerland.
I sure do.
I was manager there, and I was working 40 hours plus there a week. So college suffered. Again, I'd be getting up late or going, you know, I didn't know what I wanted. I didn't want to be a lab tech was really the applied chemistry. I didn't want to do that. I was doing the course. I liked the social element of it, being at college, being around other students, made some really good friends, but no interest. So then I worked in fast food for a while, but I knew I wanted to go back to college and do something. And when I was in CBS, we had done there was a TV station in CBS. One of the teachers, Matt Kelly, who now works in television, goes off, you know, film and stuff.
I know Matt,
literally a TV station. We used to make different programs, and one of the things we made, myself and three other lads, we won an All-Ireland competition for a documentary we made about Shannon Airport. And we won three or four awards in total over 2 or 3 years, but we won the overall award and won a trip to London and stuff like that. So it was, I had an interest in that, in making television, or creating something, like creating entertainment, we'll call it. And that was, I went back as a mature student then to Coláiste na Dúlaigh in Dublin, did a media communications course, which was television, photography and radio. And while there, we'd make fake TV programs, basically, as projects, and no one wanted to present them. And I said, you know, you got the same marks if you presented them as the people who did all the script, directed it, all the hard work. So you could just show up on the day of the project and present it. And I said, yeah, that's the E. But I even presented the other half, like there was four groups in the class. I did three of the four because literally nobody else wanted to do it. So I ended up presenting it. So it kind of got me comfortable performing, for want of a better word.
In front of people, yeah.
In front of people and a camera. So I was happy enough to do that. And I had to go backwards a little bit. I'd seen Billy Connolly when I was 18 in Limerick, in the Royal, Theatre Royal. And I never laughed so much before in my life or since. And I said to my girlfriend at the time, I want to do that, being a stand-up comedian. Now, saying that is like watching, you know, Messi playing football and going, oh, do you know, I might start playing football. You know, it was that level of, what do you, like, I didn't even know how you began. You know, like, you can't, like, I'd never done. It took me 10 years from deciding I wanted to do comedy to going on stage, which it was just, oh, like, I was a very shy person, you know, which I always laugh when I read, you know, famous actors or singers or comedians who say, oh, I was terribly shy. And people go, but you want to go, I know exactly. I think it's a reaction to the shyness is where performance comes from. And that was gradually then when I was in college and presenting these things and maturing as a human as well. You know, I was getting
of course, into my
mid-20s. I kind of was growing up and went, I wasn't as afraid. And then a girl I was living with, one of my friends, a friend of hers came to stay with us who was a stand-up comedian. And we went to see her do a gig, and I didn't think she was great. but she got paid 70 quid for it. And I literally was looking for a part-time job at the time. And I'm thinking, she's just got 70 quid for 50 minutes. And I went looking to try and get a gig then. Literally, that was the motivation, was to earn some money, which was the wrong attitude when it comes to stand-up comedy. But I did a gig. It was a weekly gig in Dublin on the 8th, but it's still going, called The Lucky Duck on a Tuesday night. And I went in and won it. And the best moment of it was, there was a Canadian comic in just passing through who just wanted to do a gig in Dublin. And I'd done my first gig. And he came up to me afterwards going, "Oh, that was brilliant, mate." And I said, "Oh, it was my first gig." And he didn't believe me. And I thought, oh, maybe I have something here. So I used to go back there for a few weeks. I won two or three of these plastic rubber ducks. And then all I knew to do then was enter the competitions. So I entered So You Think You're Funny, which was a Channel 4 competition. I entered an RTE New Comedy Awards competition. This is in 2000. And I met Russell Brand in Edinburgh. He's the one who beat me in my semi-final. Never met him again. And I was joint winner of the RTE thing. So that kind of got me known. Once he won the RTE thing, because the Irish comedy community is so small, everyone knew me then. All the comics, even if I hadn't met them, they're aware, oh, this new guy, you know, and he's not bad. So I was literally getting calls from like Jerry Mallon, who booked and ran a club in Galway, kind of used to tour with Tommy Tiernan for years. He rang me, got my number, rang me and booked me for a gig. So I was getting paid, you know, and I was like, oh, this is great. So that was the start, and then just up from there.
But I suppose even from winning that RTE Best New Act Award for comedy, that was massive, we'll say, for your profile, as you said. It made you, because the circle is so small in Ireland, everyone started to know, you know. And I mean, you went to Montreal then later on after that, and you did all the comedy festivals along the way. You were really up on a statue at this stage, you know, after doing all that.
Was a massive moment, because as much as I said, seeing Billy Connolly live, that was the first thing I ever went to. Montreal was kind of the thing that got me interested, because it had been on TV. So it was kind of me being exposed. Like, you know, it's funny now when you think of YouTube and so many TV channels, you just wouldn't see stand-up on television. You know, you'd see someone coming on the Late Late with Gay Byrne. So it would be someone like Billy Connolly on the Late Late, but it would be someone like Tom O'Connor, and doing gags, but they're, you know, as brilliantly as someone like Tom O'Connor or whoever, Frank Carson, doing the gags, it wasn't connecting as such. I found them very funny, but at the time I would have been 16, 17. But then I saw Montreal on television. We got the we call them the BBC channels, but I mean BBC, ITV and Channel 4 in our house, and they had programs from Montreal, and you see, I saw Bill Hicks and just blew my Emo Phillips, Steve Wright, you know, all these comics, all very different, and I just oh my God, it's a whole world out there. And so from seeing Montreal to playing Montreal, it was a few years, but it was an amazing thing to be there. I felt like I was at the World Cup. I felt like I was, you know, represented, because it was like I was over there with Ed Byrne and, you know, doing the Irish show, and David O'Doherty and Brendan Dempsey. We had it was just this amazing feeling of, I'm at the Comedy World Cup here.
This is the Olympic Games of comedy, like, yeah. It was the Olympic Games of comedy, like, you know, it was massive.
Yeah, I'd say the World Cup. I'm more of a football fan than
anything. So am I, but I just threw in the Olympic Games just for our viewers.
I was so wrong, in fairness.
Well, Karl, come here then. I mean, at this stage of your life, were you were solely a comedian at this stage, were you?
At that stage, by 2003, I was full-time at comedy, but I had been working in the medical supplies company in Limerick at the same time. But I would, you know, my mate John was kind of the warehouse manager. So I had it that I could leave, you know, when I had gigs.
You
so
had got to the stage like
where, yeah, it got to let me go. Like, I ran out of holidays very quickly. But, like, they understood, yeah, I was doing this part-time, you know, the job. And I worked very hard when I was there. But it got to the stage where I wasn't showing up for 3 weeks.
Yeah.
He did it as a friend. He sent me my P45. It was almost like, just go.
Just walk away.
Just go. And I was like, at the time, I was like, what? I need the money. I went, no, I don't. But it was killing me because I was working. If I was around, I was working the 5 days and then going away. Like, I'd fly away for the weekend, mainly to the UK. You know, at the time, you do a weekend in the UK, so 3 out of 4. So yeah. I was going 7 days a week. Like, sometimes I'd get back from the UK, I'd fly into Dublin if I had to, you know, get the train home. So I'd get home at 10 at night on a Sunday, and I'm getting up at 7 to go to work. And I'm like, 7 days a week, I'm going. I used to take my passports out of a bag of dirty clothes that had been left from the previous weekend and repack my clean clothes. Like, so I was buying clothes. I ended up with loads of t-shirts, socks and underwear from just not having time. You know, I didn't drive at the time. I would have just thrown them all into a laundrette. But yeah, it was great. They're great times, you know, great times from going over to the UK, gigging lots of people now who are massive stars, you know.
Unbelievable, and, yeah.
Just having a great weekend, you know, great weekends in different parts of the UK. It's a scene that's, you know, that kind of has changed and dropped a bit since, you know, when I go over to, like, I go to a place in Bristol and it would be there Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. And then, you know, that club, through different economic reasons, whatever, it would become Friday, Saturday. So I'd stop going over there. But I was making enough money in Ireland at the time anyway, so it was less of an issue.
So what did family think then? I mean, did they believe in Karl Spain, the comedian, or were they thinking it was just a phase you were going through?
I'm glad you asked that, because when I mentioned the RTE competition, the day before I went up to it, or maybe the morning, I said to my father, "Do you know, Dad, I think I can win this. Right? I think I'm going to win this," because I'd seen a few of the other lads, and I thought, I'm better than him. I'm better. So I said to my father, "I think I can win this." And his response was not best of luck. He went, "Don't think like that, because you're going to be disappointed when you don't win."
The typical dad.
And I was so annoyed with him. I was going, "Jesus, could you not just fake it for like?"
Of course.
So when I won, it's all like, you know, "All ye doubters, good luck to you." And it was like, "There you go, Dad."
Yeah. Well, he probably said, "I knew you could do it, son."
No, in fairness, they were very proud. The funny thing was, it was the Late Late Show. I got on the Late Late Show because of that. And that was the moment, I think, for family members. I'm trying to think now. I think it was one of my cousins, when they heard I was on the Late Late Show, went, "Karl Spain on the Late Late Show. Oh, my God. Mother Teresa, Patrick Duffy, and now Karl Spain."
You were up there with the trio.
Which, I the Holy Trinity of chat show guests. Excellent. Yeah, so although that was the most terrifying moment ever. I was waiting to go on. So they had the first guest on, and then they brought me out. They put a microphone on the studio floor, and I'm standing there, and I'm just thinking, and I certainly found out afterwards, everyone I knew was literally watching. Like, the amount of people who said it to me, even people I hadn't met yet, saw me on the Late Late that night. And the guest that was on was Sinead O'Connor. And Sinead O'Connor has been interviewed. She'd sold her house and donated the money to Father Joe Young for a suicide refuge. So I'm standing, I didn't know, I knew, like, Sinead was on, but I didn't know what she talked about. So next thing I see Father Joe Young up on the screen, a picture, and I'm like, what's he doing, you know? Why is there, you know, the Limerick, whatever. And then I hear what you're talking about. I'm standing on the studio floor, already terrified. And I look into the audience and I see people crying in the RT, in the studio there, in the Late studio. And I'm looking at this woman. And this before they know I'm coming, they just see me standing. They don't know who I am. I'm looking at this woman crying. And I suddenly go from terror to, oh my God, this is the worst moment of my life. And the producer, they told me, "You 5 minutes, and as soon as you're finished, we're going to break." And I did 3.5 minutes, and I feel like that, I got a burst of applause from one of the jokes I did, and I just went, "Oh, that's enough." And I just wrapped up, and they went to break. But it was unbelievable. That one of the funny stories, like, David O'Doherty said that was the first time he'd seen me. He was watching, who's this guy? He'd no idea, didn't know I existed. But the funniest was two guys I'd been in college with. And one, it was literally one of the first people I told I wanted to be a stand-up was a friend in college. And he was at home with his mate. And they were smoking something illegal. They were off their heads. And one of them said, will we turn on the television? And they turned on the television. And it was literally the moment where I went, hello. And it said, it freaked them out. They said, they're never more freaked out. Like they were just literally going, Karl, it's in the television. Like what? Like they panicked. It was just one of those, again, one of those crazy moments.
And they never again smoked illegal stuff.
I'd say it was a weird intervention, but they put them on the straight and narrow straight after that.
You had a rough year, did of course, in 2004. Your mum passed away, sadly.
It did, yes, yeah. I used to joke about her. She ultimately died of a heart attack, but she had Parkinson's for a number of years, and I exercised my comedy muscles when I'd look after my mother, because she couldn't move. She'd be hunched in the chair, and I'd go out, and instead of, oh, come on, you're all right, you know, I'd try and make her laugh. So I used to pretend to be a priest. I'd be telling her stuff from the confession that I'd heard from the neighbours. I'd be making up stories, obviously, about the neighbours and stuff I heard. And, geez, it's a dark man, that fella. You wouldn't take it now, looking at him. Oh, I'll tell you now, Jerry's a terrible man. And sometimes I pretend to be a doctor talking to me and saying, oh, she's gone. And it all made her laugh. I used to juggle Parkinson's. Exactly, to get her laughing and then make her tea and toast or whatever I was doing. And I used to joke saying, like, she's like Muhammad Ali, she's Parkinson's, but, she kept boxing even though there was no chance of a world title fight. Loads of them forgotten, because this before I was a performer, I would, I would have done a lot of this through the 90s. So it was part of that, of being a frustrated performer in many ways before I had the stage, I think.
Well, you would have always said that that you got your resilience and your toughness from your mum.
I think so, yeah. And I think I don't know the exact percentage, but I can see both of my parents in me. I certainly look like my father, but in certain personality traits, I'm definitely him. In others, I'm my mother. I can see them both. And I was very close. I was probably closer to my parents than my brothers and sisters, and certainly my mom looking after. I would have been there, especially when I was working in fast food or working, I'd have been the only one there during the day. So I'd have been spending time with her, watching television with her, watching 15 to 1 or whatever with her, making her tea or coffee. She never drank coffee. I don't know why I'm making up lies. That developed my comedy muscles there. But when she died, it wasn't intended as such, but I did her eulogy. And one of the lines I said was, which is true, everyone, and it is the truth, everyone used to say my mother was a very glamorous, gorgeous woman. They'd go, oh, Jerry Costello, oh, Jerry was very beautiful. And then they'd pause, look at me and go, she's very like your father, And the funny thing, I said that at the altar and it got a big laugh in the church. And I felt guilty going, oh, geez, I can't believe I'm after getting a laugh during a eulogy. But I remember when I was carrying the coffin out, and I tried not to look at anyone because I said, I'll remember them as being there when I had the coffin on my shoulder. But I remember seeing two of my mother's friends and I thought, oh, they're crying, but they weren't. They told me afterwards they were still laughing at the joke. And I'm going, it was a weird guilty thing, but it's also a thing of, I think, it's in the comic DNA of no matter where you are, it's sometimes like, you think of a joke, exactly, it's almost terrified, like someone goes, oh, something happened, they'll tell you some terrible news and you'll think of a joke and you go, you really can't say that.
But even as a child, I remember being an altar boy as a child, and you're sitting, you're directly across from the other altar boy, and all he used to do was look at you funny, and the two of you are skitting above at the altar, it doesn't matter. Just the smallest little thing. My next question, Karl, for you is, what was in your head when you decided to do Karl Wants a Woman?
heart, yeah. It takes every kind of people to make the world go round.
What was going on in your head?
It was, I'll tell you what happened was, I had done a little bit of work on Des Bishop's work experience.
Mm.
And the people in RTE, there was a woman, Jennifer Griffin was her name, who'd come up with that idea for Des. I did the warm-ups and I was watching, because I'd worked in Abracadabra as well for a summer, and Des was working. So I was watching some of the footage and trying to think of jokes or talk through jokes with him. So I was around and I did the warm-ups, and Jennifer said, oh, RTE would love to do something with you. They've been talking about me. And because I'd done TV production, I'd done a dating show in college. We did a show about how dating is going to change in the 21st century.
Mm.
And we look back at, you know, arranged marriages and, you know, all that sort of thing. And at the time, 21 years ago, internet dating was barely starting. So there would have been dating agencies. And we were looking at how this is now going to develop. You would have had things. And when I did it in college, my one regret was we didn't put someone through it. We didn't do some of the dates. We didn't test out, you know, newspaper dating or whatever like that. Mm. And, you know, little ads. So they said to me, have you any ideas for a show? And I just thought of that college project. And I said, oh, that would be like, and it was a different idea at the time. It was about a comic look at going through the dating scene, going out on dates and then did stand up about it. And, you know, I was there, I had to kind of change how I was describing it. I thought, oh, shut up, you're describing Seinfeld. But it would have been that thing of talking through with friends afterwards and going, this happened, that happened, and talk through the dates. And they were very interested in it. I remember going to pitch the idea to RTE, and the producer was there to me, this is where I do, this is where I sell the show for you. And I went in and the RTE people said, so tell us about this. And I went, oh, I spoke for about 20 minutes. And it was like I was doing material. I was sitting down, facing people, but I was telling a story. Like, I ended up genuinely on a date with someone. The date finished with me, her, and her boyfriend having a drink because I totally misread signals. I was telling stories of other people's dates. Like, there was a girl I worked, she worked on a TV program telling us, we were telling bad date stories, and she told the story of, she was in San Francisco for summer and kind of got friendly and shifted a guy and then brought him into the apartment one night. They're having a few drinks. Then she said, oh, you can go now. He goes, can I stay? And I went, oh, I don't want to do anything. But he was homeless. She picked up a homeless guy because she'd seen him around.
Oh, Jesus.
So we're talking about different things with that. I had them really laughing and they went, yeah, this is great. And I went and did the show. It became something different as we were doing it because we literally weren't sure what we were doing, but we went through the different processes. But the girl I met on the show, we're still together. We're living together now. We're together. What date is it today? It's the 20th. So we're together 14 years, 7 months and 18 Whoa. Days. So, yeah, for all the laughing about it and whatever, it's you know, it works, and it was one of those things of, yeah, it was one of those things, like, it genuinely wasn't I wasn't like, oh my, you know, but everyone said, oh, you were so desperate. It wasn't even that. It was meant to be just get on television. And it was similar to the Des Bishop work experience. Like, the template was, you know, you go, he was going to Abracadabra doing this. I'm going out on dates, I'm talking to a camera, he's talking to a camera. So, and it was only afterwards I realized we literally, you know, took the template from the Des Bishop work experience. But it was a success. Ratings and all that, I sound like Trump. The best numbers. But yeah, it was great. No, it was
a success for both of you, RTE or 3E, RTE yourself and Rachel. Yeah.
Rachel won me. She previously won a bike. I think she preferred the bike.
You went on then, of course, to do Podge and Raj.
Oh, right. Is that on YouTube or something? Is it, or did you just find this?
Oh, yeah. We found you. We found you, girl.
Podge
and Raj, Kilna Scully. And, of course, you've done several nights on the panel.
The panel was kind of, I think I was, if someone wasn't around, like if they didn't have flights for Andrew Maxwell or Ed Byrne or someone, I got the call. So I did a lot. The Podge and Rodge thing was the, I did a couple of those different versions. It was on with Lamal from Catch a Google one time, and my impression was the guy barely tied his laces. He seemed to be not knowing where he was or what was going on. They were good fun. It was weird that I'd met the two lads previously, but when you do the show, you don't meet them.
It's and the funniest ball game, thing yeah. about
yeah, the funniest thing about doing the Punch and Rodge thing was I know they're puppets, okay, but you're sitting across the table and there's two puppets, and when they speak, the voice comes from miles away through a speaker. Now you can hear it really loudly, but it's almost like you're looking at the wrong person. So that was the
you have to train your brain, like yeah.
Now they were slagging me, and I felt. Afterwards, I thought, God, lad, if you told me you were going to slag me, I could have given you way better stuff. But the funny one about killing a Scully was I played a self-defense instructor who is teaching kids self-defense, and Joe Rooney's character is brought in because he got beaten up. And then I bring Joe up and kick the shit out of him in the scene, just to, you know, because I'm a bully, whatever. But I think it was the Sunday People. I had the picture of me dressed in Kung Fu gear with the head. And I don't know where they got the wrong end of the stick, but they had me down as a sex instructor, like Dr. Ruth.
Lovely.
And I was like, Karl Spain plays a black belt sex instructor. And I was like, where did they get this?
It's mental, the crossovers you get with the media, though, sometimes.
Yeah. So yeah, the TV stuff is it can be, some of it can be amazing. It's great fun. The one I keep slagging, I'm on the 6 o'clock show so much, but I must find it. I know I taped it, but I was on with Micheál and Murray Hertig one night, and they were asking him about teams from the 50s, and he's naming everyone on the team, naming everything, remembering everything, and they're just going like, what a memory, you're unbelievable. And he turns to me and goes, yeah, I was just chatting to Mark outside. And my face was like, why can't I remember my name? And I think it shows the priorities. Like, I think it's GAA study, making those things aren't as important.
Ah, oh, class. Is it fair to say at this stage in your life you were like, are you a comedian nonstop? Are you 7 days a week in your head, 24/7 a comedian? Or do you zone out for when you're off stage?
No, I wouldn't it's there in the background. Do you know what I mean? It's there in the background. If I'm chatting with someone, I'll think of something. But I can I'm like the lads, comics would say always on, you know. Broadband, all cars and broadband. I was on, you know, because they'd be slagging and having the crack. But even then, I do, like I was saying, it's become material. Even if I'm out for a coffee and you go, or you're going to a cafe or whatever, and they go, okay, sit wherever you like, I'll go, okay, can you move those people? You know, and then the person will start laughing. But I have a few of those where, you know, you're out and about, and I go, God, and sometimes I go, will you just shut up?
Yeah.
But I suppose,
when you're on stage, and Carl, when you're on stage, I mean, are you feeding off people in the audience, or are you on spec? Like, are you
mostly now? Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I host a late show in Galway during the festival in October. I'm there for like four or five nights. I've maybe like the whole week between galas, opening and closing galas. I'll host, and I have the dream lineup. You'll have all the biggest names. John Bishop was watching last year, and he said, "Oh, I want to get up." And John was It was amazing because I was slagging him in the intro. I knew John years ago. Literally, I had with myself and John Bishop. I was going to pitch a TV show idea with John for RTE, and I was in his house, and he said, I've something else that might happen, which was, I think it was To Think It's All Over, the one on Sky. He literally went to TV, he just went whoosh almost immediately. As soon as I thought of getting involved with John, he just became a huge success elsewhere. But he popped up. I slagged him by saying, oh, John was in the TV show The Accused, but he was seriously miscast as he played Robert Sheehan's father. Now, Robert Sheehan is beautiful. That's not a good piece of casting. And John laughed at it. He knows it's not a bad... John got up and did 15 minutes about being on that TV show, in that drama, off the cuff, told a beautiful story that he'd never told anywhere. And it was one of the most impressive things I've seen for a while. It's just brilliant. But that show, yeah, I won't do material in that show that week. I'll be just working off the audience.
Yeah, no, I think it's fantastic when you can do that, and you can still make people laugh on the spotlight, which is fantastic.
Yeah, it's so much fun. And every night we finish, I go, oh, that was amazing. And there's a thought, oh, we'll never do it tomorrow. And we do. Now, the big help is that you've got an amazing lineup as well. So you'll have Rich Hall, Restart, Kevin Bridges, Sean Lott. You'll have amazing comics coming on. So the audience are there going, they're already in a good mood, knowing they're going to have a great night. They just chat to you, and it's a bit of fun. Yeah, yeah. So it's a wonderful, wonderful week of the year. Let's hope we have it this year.
Hopefully, yeah. So you like myself, Carol, you have diabetes as well. You're a type 2 diabetic.
I am, yeah, yeah.
How is that with you? Have you
got any problems? I've got gestation. I got it. The one when you're pregnant. That's the one I have.
You haven't got rid of it yet, though, no?
No. The funny thing is, I think that lockdown is helping because I'm not on the road eating bad food. We're cooking 3 meals a day here.
It's hard. It must be hard when you're on the road because, I mean, you need a fast bite to eat.
You need
a fast takeaway. I know that for myself. Like.
The funny thing is, I keep saying the only weight I've put on is hair.
You went on in to do the course of celebrity operation transformation. That's lovely, Carl. Love it.
Yeah, this isn't going to work. If you're only listening, it's like flock of seagulls.
It's class. Hair. It's class. It's a new. I think you should let it grow, man. It's a whole new.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It would be. Yeah, if I get the ponytail, if I get as far as a ponytail, I could look like the comic book store guy from The Simpsons. Would be the. I'd have to grow the little goatee then for Halloween. But Operation Transformation was. I correct myself. Celebrity Operation Transformation was great fun. It told me, I'm living with Rachel probably, more than 10 years now, but I remember the point where she said, oh, I just wish you'd cook dinner once. And now I cook it at least a couple of times a week, which was the big change from that. Now, I did a cookery course, funnily enough, up in the presentation. And once a week for 8 weeks or something it was. And it was just learning to cook. I was like, and we're really embracing it. And I said it to Colin Murphy, our great Northern Irish comedian. And I said to Colin, I'm cooking now. And he looked at me, and it was the most beautiful put down. He went, my wife says, if you can read, you can cook. Because you just have to follow instructions.
Follow the instructions, you'll be fine.
Yeah, and it certainly knocked the smug pride out of me for my cookery and culinary skills,
So now Rachel is hoping that she can go out for a takeaway some night.
we went actually for Supermax there a few days ago, first one in 3 months. It was literally like it was open. And we just went out for a spin, just, we're living pretty much near Fanshawe, so we're near the city centre. So we weren't breaking any rules. We went for a spin and we said, would we just get Supermax instead of going home and cooking dinner? And we had Supermax. It was amazing. It was amazing. God, this is great. We'll have it again tomorrow. No, we won't.
Last year, Carl, was a big year for you. You toured internationally, of course, as you said already, with Kevin Bridges. And of course, you had your show deal with Bernard O'Shea.
I toured with both Bernard and Kevin. We toured Ireland with Bernard. It was a European tour with Kevin, and it was from the 1st of April to the 1st of May 2019. And the sad thing was all the anniversaries that were coming up on my Facebook. This was this time last year. Reykjavik was great fun, wasn't it? I'd never thought in a year's time I'd be sitting at home. I not to dismiss Bernard, but I think Kevin Bridges is, I'm a friend of Kevin's. How I became friendly with him was I did a gig with him in Edinburgh when he was only going about 3 or 4 months.
Mm.
And I recommended him for gigs in Ireland. So he got loads of gigs. And like he came over very early in his career when he played City Limits in Cork, the Laughter Lounge, the Ocean Dove, everywhere. Yeah, and yeah. I just said, this guy's great. Now, it's one of those, it's like, it doesn't take any talent to spot someone that talented.
Yes.
I just said, this guy's brilliant. And I think Kevin never forgot that. I think that was part of the thing. Now, we met up with similar interests. We're going into football. We get on really well. But, I'd gone from then, I hadn't seen him for a couple of years. You'd meet him at a festival and we'd have a great, great chat or whatever. But I was over in Glasgow doing gigs.
Before you go on, Carl, sorry, who do you support in football?
Manchester United.
Oh, we'll move on, so keep going again. It's all right.
But that was that's the sad thing, is that if the Premier League season isn't ended, we'll never know who would have won.
Okay, keep going. Social distancing from the trophy. We're praying that the league will go on. We're praying, Carl.
I don't know. 6 people have tested positive. I don't think it should go on. I think they should just all share it.
Anyway, moving on. Swiftly moving on.
So we got on. We got, I just get on. We have a good laugh. But I love watching him. I think he's one of the great minds. Certainly he's only early 30s. I'm a huge fan of a lot of comics. I love watching lots of comics. But of the younger comics, I think he's, relatively young. He's certainly one of the best, and he'll make me laugh consistently on and off stage as well. We have the crack.
But even for yourself, Carl, I mean, it must be a very great sense of pride in yourself, in your inner self, when you're touring internationally and people are recognizing you. Like, you're known all over the world now, just like you've toured countries in the world.
I've gigged everywhere except South America. I've been in all over Europe. A lot of Asia, Australia, New Zealand, America, Canada, all over Ireland. Like places in Ireland and the UK I'd never heard of growing up. And you find places with theatres and venues and stuff like that. And it's a great life. Well, it was up until the start of March. I was actually meant to be. I was meant to be in China for Paddy's week. Now that went quickly once the Wuhan outbreak happened. I knew I wasn't going to China.
That was a quick decision.
And then it was Hong Kong. And I was thinking Hong Kong is probably not going to happen. And it was meant to be Hong Kong, China, then Australia. So once China went, Australia went, because China was in the middle.
Of course, yeah.
But it was literally, I'd replaced the gigs with new gigs and they went. So it's... It's interesting,
You've also taken up, I suppose, a kind of a stellar role as an MC for most of these comedy gigs. How do you feel about that? Are you happy doing that, or would you prefer being the comic itself?
I love doing that certainly for the festivals, whether it's the Cat Laughs or Galway or the Ivy Gardens, or whatever.
I saw you above an Electric Picnic last year.
I was there for the whole lot. For 2 days there.
2 days, yeah.
And you're trying everything. The great fun there was my cousin's kids were there, and I got one of them up on stage. There was lots of fun and games throughout the 2 days. But I met people afterwards. And like I was, for those listening and don't know, I was MC for the 2 days. So between every act, I was bringing them off, bringing on the next act. And I was on a flight, and the person sitting next to me had been after Electric Picnic and was telling me, oh, I saw that act and that act. Did you see anyone else? I'm like, yeah. No. I said, what about the MC? And I'm going, I don't really remember the MC. I was going, for fuck's sake. I was killing myself for 2 days. People going, oh, no, we go down there and watch Foy Lambs and Hog. And then go, but I was there for 5 minutes before, I don't remember that. Just remember trying to get a seat. But it actually was great fun over the 2 days. There was lots of people who came and stayed for long bits of it.
No, it was very enjoyable.
Yeah, you have to not get too upset when you see someone asleep, 20 feet from the stage. Because before it's not you, it's...
yeah, it's not you, it's me. Yeah. Before we finish up, Karl, what would you say to a 10-year-old Karl Spain?
Jesus.
Would you say Jesus to him?
I don't know what I'd say.
What advice would you give him?
I'd say boo first. I don't know. I don't know if a 10-year-old me would have taken any advice in. I would first thing I would tell, look, you're not going to make it as a footballer.
That's your dad breaking out on you.
So stop those dreams now. Anything funny you hear, write it down. Keep notebooks for stuff now. Or any funny stories, make note of them, because that's where you're going. Get over the stupid shyness. And I don't know. I'd love to go back to being like a 10-year-old or 12-year-old or whatever with the knowledge I have now and start all over again.
Oh,
you know, life would be such a breeze then, wouldn't it?
That's for sure. That's for sure.
Maybe the post-school me.
Yeah. Listen, Karl, I hope yourself, thanks a million, first of all, for taking time out to talk to me.
No problem.
I hope yourself and Rachel, I hope this coronavirus clears up very quick and you get the show back on the road, as the fella says. I hope yourself and Rachel really are very safe.
All fingers crossed. Thanks a million, Damien.